Good evening. I just arrived from Belgium. With my good luck, there was a heavy wind. So instead of 7 hours, it took 9.5 hours, the flight. Almost like from Israel. So I arrived and I ran quickly to Brooklyn to give a shiur in a school. I had a meeting now. Now we have this shiur and there's another shiur after that. And tomorrow night in Jamaica, Bezrat Hashem. So I hope I won't fall asleep in the middle of the shiur. But let me tell you, you know, every time I go to places, there's a new community that I went this time. The last two times that I went there was an Ashkenazi community organization. So it was all European, mainly Ashkenazim. This time was Faradim, mainly Georgians. There's a very big community of Georgians in Antwerp. Amazing, 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 amazing. Not only nice people, it's people who are so hungry and thirsty for the Torah. When I went to Istanbul, I was shocked how the people was hungry for Torah. Well, over there, how much Torah they have. But over here, it's a city of lots of Torah. But the people want not only Torah, they want strong Musar. They said to the person who organized it, we will only help you if you bring a speaker that will give it to us in our face. Hard, not soft. First time in 18 years I hear such thing. Usually everywhere you go, they warn you 50 times. Don't say this, be careful with that. You usually say that, please don't say it this time. People may get offended. Over here, speak the hardest you can. So it was hours and hours of hours, one lecture after the other, each lecture 2 hours, 2 hours, 2 hours. We did Melava Malka over there, it becomes dark only after 10 now. After 10 it becomes dark. Still light there at 10 o'clock. So 11:30 people coming to the lecture on Saturday night. 11:30 at night, the lecture is normal. I said to the guy, well, who's going to come at 11:30? It will be packed. 11:30, packed. The shul packed. 11:45, people still coming. Amazing. Amazing what's happening. Baruch Hashem. Very happy to see that the words of the prophet are happening. Happening in front of our eyes. What did he say? Before Mashiach come, Hashem will make the Jews all over the world thirsty for Torah. More and more communities. Now they're speaking about going to Vienna. Also a large Bukharian community in Vienna. I didn't know. Yeah. I keep learning new and new things in Baruch Hashem. The Gemara says like this. Amar Rabbi Natan. Rabbi Natan say, you know, we have mitzvah of Birkat HaMazon. From all the prayers that we have in Judaism, not that many people know that that's the, basically, it's the highest prayer from all the prayers. Why it's the highest? Because all the other prayers, almost all of them are rabbinical obligation. It's an obligation from the Torah to pray to Hashem. Don't get me wrong. From the Torah. Hashem wants us to pray to Him every day. But how to pray to Him? What words to say to Him? It's up to us. Everyone in his own language speaks to Hashem, is already doing a mitzvah from the Torah. So it's really interesting. If a person now sit and put tefillin, and if a person say 2 or 3 sentences to Hashem, it's the same thing. That's mitzvah from the Torah, and this person who's driving his car and say, Hashem, I'm in the middle of, I'm on my way to a meeting, help me that the meeting will be successful. That's mitzvah from the Torah, to speak to Hashem. So the more we speak to Hashem, the more mitzvot we do. And that's besides the benefits that Hashem loves to answer to those who count on Him, those who rely on Him. If you ask Him, this is what we say. We say to Hashem, when we pray every morning, what do we say? יסי חסדך השם עלינו כאשר יחלנו לך. Your kindness on us should be according to how much we hope for your help. Which means, this is a very interesting verse. If I don't hope for your help, I'm not counting on your help, technically I'm saying in a tefillah, don't help me, I don't deserve it. When do I deserve to get it? When I throw everything on you. Help, do for me, help me, help me, I'm nothing without you. Then you have incentive to help you. Just like with the kids. You have two kids. One is managing. Don't help me, don't punish me. The other one, everything. Abba, Abba, I need this. Abba, I need that. Abba, help me. Abba, this guy is hurting me. You know, this kid is dependable. He's depending on you. How can you let him down? It's very interesting. How many people know that if they would speak more to Hashem, their life would look 100 times better? Now some people say, I pray every day, 3 times a day, it's enough, how much more I can talk to Hashem? Wrong. Sometimes even a 5 minutes conversation between you and Hashem in your own language is better than the whole 3 prayers a day. Why? You're a robot when you pray, you don't think about one word. Somebody stop you in the middle, where are you now? I don't remember. Doesn't know what he is, he's paying attention to what he say. It's a robot, he comes, he reads, thinks about something else. Doesn't really break his heart in the prayers. If you ever saw, I show a video of the tzaddik from Monsi, of Mordechai Steiner, that's his name. Remember, if somebody asks you who is the biggest tzaddik in the world, the biggest, that is close to Hashem more than any human being on earth, the answer is Rav Mordechai Steiner from Monsi. You don't believe me? You see the video that I show in the lecture in Miami 2 years ago. Go search for that lecture in Miami. The last 10 minutes, I showed him how he pray. After you see how he pray, you understand. Running, screaming, jumping, crying. Like a person that beg for his life. But like a person that another second the knife come and chop his head off, how he scream and beg, goes on his knees, please don't kill me. Nobody wants to die. Huh? This is how he pray since his bar mitzvah. Since he was bar mitzvah, not when he became 40. Once you become 40, your mind is settling down, become more conservative, you know how to put things in the right way on a scale. Younger than that, you may make mistakes, jump to conclusion too fast. But he, since his bar mitzvah is like that, I heard it from 2 different sources. One, that his father was learning with him in yeshiva, and another person in Israel, that he's his relative. Told me, oh, you're from Monsi? You know my uncle? Who's this, your uncle? So yeah, and then he said, my uncle, he was like this since his bar mitzvah. 2 people told me. Bar mitzvah! Kids today in bar mitzvah, what do they know? They know they pray b'chlal. They're not in a very good yeshiva. The parents have to beg them to bring a sidur. They want to run, to play. Since his bar mitzvah is like this, you see, it's not a regular soul. It's a very special soul, this guy. Amazing. Be'emet incredible. Incredible. What emunah in Hashem. What devotion. It's like a... I don't know, I mean, I never saw in history, I really tell you the truth, in history, I never saw ever, in reality, I mean, obviously, we don't know how it was in the time of David HaMelech, we read Tehillim, we understand, but I never saw in history any proof that somebody can be so connected to Hashem like this rabbi. Unbelievable, incredible. So if we be 1% like him, 1%, believe me, you're going to see a tremendous change in your life. You talk to Hashem, you feel Hashem's presence around you. Because remember, a father wants to help his son much more when the son counting on him. When the son is independent, the father leave him alone. Chas v'shalom. So now, in Birkat HaMazon, the first 3 blessings is the Oraita. And then after that, it's the Rabbanan. The Chachamim added everything to this blessing because since it's the only obligation from the Torah to actually pray to Hashem is ve'achalta ve'savata uverachta et Hashem Elokecha. You should eat and be full and bless Hashem. It's a sentence in the Torah. So after you're full and you bless Hashem, that's now an obligation from the Torah. It's not rabbinical law that you have to pray Tfilat Shmona Esrei. It's an obligation from the Torah. Since it's an obligation from the Torah, the Chachamim added in the end all the personal request and the general request that a Jew needs in his life. And most of the Jews, it takes them less than 2 minutes to do Birkat HaMazon, and they don't have intention to one word of what they say. Quick, like a robot. Just let's get it over with. The tragedy is that when a person die one day, and he say to Hashem, why I suffered here, why I had this, why I was unemployed for here, why I had that, why I had... So Hashem will answer him one answer, because you never blessed me once in your life. Normally, the way it should be. Everything was just to finish. Let's finish, finish. Finish, no, no. You know the people that come to shul before the davening start, they already look every 5 seconds in their watch. And when they give somebody that pray very fast, they give him the job, everyone is breathing. Ah, what a relief. Why? He's going to save 10 minutes on Shabbat. So if he started, if he's supposed to finish 10:30, he will finish now 10:20. Ah, what a relief. No, so what's the rush? 10:20, he's going to spend another hour in the shul and waste time speaking Lashon Hara. What was he so anxious to finish 10 minutes faster? He's going to save lives? He goes to learn Torah? Hey, Rav Ovadia Yosef, he doesn't want to waste time. He wants the prayer to go quickly, 1, 2, 3, right away. As soon as he finishes, he opens a book. Always. For him, he wants to learn more Torah. No, very good. But the people who are in a rush, they stay in a shul, they mingle, they talk, they drink. What's the rush?
Well, what happens if you mind wanders? Because you can be davening slow, and you might be wandering here, wandering there, but if it's fast, your mind is...
The mind, whether you daven fast, whether you daven slow, usually is not here, the mind. Mm-hmm. Unless if you really, really want it to be here. Mm-hmm. You understand? I give you an example. Before you start praying, so I say to you, Sami, listen, I have a machine here. I'm connecting it to your brain now, and it reads your mind on a screen. Every time I see on the screen a word that doesn't belong to Tfilat Shmona Esrei, there's a gun automatically shoots right into your head. Mm-hmm. Do you think you're going to think about an extra word besides the Shmona Esrei? Mm-hmm. So you see, it's possible to control it. Mm-hmm. Why we think? Because we are mezalzel. You know what mezalzel means? It comes from the word zol. Zol means cheap. Mm-hmm. It's too cheap in our eyes. Right? Too cheap in our eyes. If Obama comes to meet with you, so Sami, they told me you're a big tzaddik, I want to meet with you. I'm giving you 5 minutes of my time. When you sit in front of him, would you check your phone if it buzzed?
No.
No, why not? I have 5 minutes with Obama, I've got to check my text now. Mm-hmm. But in a shul, he does. Mm-hmm. Or he thinks about other things. With him, he's going to pay attention. Wow, it's an opportunity that will not return. Right? Mm-hmm. Like everything else in life. I always say to people, when you know who you're dealing with, your entire life looks different. When you know who you're dealing with. When you think you deal with nothing, you treat him like a nothing. I give you an example. Sometimes you meet a person, you don't know who he is. You give him the proper respect. But as soon as you find out who he is, everything about you changes. All of a sudden you talk differently, you run, you serve. Ah, what happened? I didn't know who you are. They say there's a story of Saadia Gaon went to some place and he had to stay in a hotel overnight. It was a snowstorm or something like that. So he went to a motel, and he said, I want a bed for the night. They said, we're very sorry, there's no chair, no available beds, no rooms. So he said, well, what am I going to do? Sleep outside in the snow? Find me a place. So they say to him, The only way you can sleep here, we give you a mattress somewhere, you know, and you sleep in the hallway. In the hallway, when people walk, they see you sleeping in the hallway. What's his option? To sleep in the snow? So he said, okay, put me in the hallway. I put him in the hallway. In the morning, remember, it was night. There was no electric in those days, more than 1,000 years ago. In the morning, the owner of the hotel recognized him. You should see what he did. He went crazy. Started to scream, to cry. The biggest rabbi in the world was laying there like a dog in the hallway. He went crazy. If I knew it, I will get the guest out of the window. Get out of here. Take your money back. The angel of God came here. Sue me, I don't care. Respect of the Torah. But they didn't know who he is. And obviously they were humbled. Not like today. Today everyone who has some job, you know who I am? The old days it wasn't like that. Can stand Gaon Mivilna, can stand in a market next to you online. He won't tell you I'm the Gaon Mivilna. And there was no Facebook to check. So nobody knew how the Chachamim looked. They only knew this big Chacham named this such and such. They didn't know his face. Unless if you live in a neighborhood, there was no way to know. So the Gemara says like this, Amar Rabbi Natan, Moshe tiken laim l'Israel birkat azan. First bracha, Baruch ata Hashem, azan et hakol, ze Moshe Rabbeinu. He wrote it. First bracha. When did he make this bracha? Who knows? When did Moshe decide to write this text? Baruch ata Hashem, azan et hakol. When? When the man fell. For the first time he saw man falling from heaven, bread. They decide to call, to say, Baruch ata Hashem, hamotzi lechem min hashamayim. And then Moshe said, bracha achrona, ken? האל עזן אותנו ואת העולם כולו בחן, בחסד, ברחמים וכו'. And it finished, ברוך אתה השם עזן את הכל. That was the ברכת המזון. That's it. ברוך אתה השם עזן את הכל, finished. In the time of Moshe Rabbeinu. When is the second ברכה was added? Second ברכה, יהושע בן נון. After Moshe passed away, יהושע בן נון became the leader. So he made the ברכה, ברוך אתה השם, על הארץ ועל המזון. Blessing you for the land. Moshe say for the bread. Yoshua say for the land. When did he say it? When they enter Israel. They occupied Israel 14 years. The Jericho. The whole story. With the Shofarot. So that's when they finally got settled in Israel. So he added one more bracha. Which is Al Haaretz Ve'al Hamazon. Who made the third bracha? Baruch Ata Hashem Bonei Yerushalayim. David and Shlomo, both of them. Some of the bracha David, some of it is son Shlomo. Al Israel amach v'al Yerushalayim irach. It's David HaMelech. Ushlomo say al habayit hagadol v'hakadosh. Why? Because David, he was in charge of Yerushalayim, but he didn't build Bet HaMikdash. So his bracha was al Israel amach v'al Yerushalayim irach. Thanking you for Jerusalem. Shlomo, he built Bet HaMikdash, so he added Al HaBayit HaGadol VaHaKadosh. And then the last bracha, Baruch Ata Hashem, HaTov VaMetiv LaChol, Shebechol Yom VaYom, Hu Etiv Lanu, Metiv Lanu, Yetiv Lanu, Gmalanu, who made this bracha? BeYavne, in the city of Yavne. What's in the city of Yavne? That's when Sanhedrin moved from Jerusalem to Yavne. Which Yavne is that? Today there is a city called Yavne in Israel. It's about 20 kilometers south from Tel Aviv. I don't think it's the same Yavne. Maybe it was a different Yavne. We have to look at the old geographical map. But there was a city called Yavne, and the Sanhedrin moved from Bet HaMikdash. They used to have a big room. It's called Lishkat HaGazit. Lishkat HaGazit. Lishkat, it's like an office, like a big room. And well, Sanhedrin used to sit there, but then they moved to Yavne. Why they moved? Who knows? Why they moved? It was supposed to be in Yerushalayim. That was the plan of Hashem. So why they decided to move them? They opened the yeshiva in Yavne and they sat over there. Why? Because they didn't want to kill Jews. What's the connection? Because the Torah said that Jews who violate Shabbat, Jews who make other sins, the sins that it has to be executed by the Jewish court. So the Torah says, there's a verse in the Torah, Me'et mizbachi tikachenu lamut. You take him to his execution from my altar. Where is my altar? There's only one place, in Yerushalayim, inside Beit HaMikdash. So it means, from here we learn that they have to sit next to the altar. They have a room next to the altar of Hashem, the Mizbeach. And when a person got convicted and he has to get killed, from there, directly they take him to his execution. They don't give him another day home to go say goodbye, make a party, you know, no. From there, directly to the execution. So as long as there was no wicked people, the Gemara say, once in 70 years, Sanhedrin executed a person, and this Sanhedrin was a cruel Sanhedrin, katlani, killer, like strict. Once in 7 years, which means other Sanhedrin even longer than that. But when they started to see there's an epidemic of wicked people, another one and another one, and now they say, well, what are we going to do? Every day we're going to kill people here? So they moved the Sanhedrin into Yavne. Because now you cannot fulfill the verse. The verse, and we have to be very precise. The Torah says, how you execute a person? You take him directly, walking him from the altar to the execution place. Since you're not sitting by the altar, that verse cannot become true. So from then on, that's like cheating. It's like doing trick. Well, I didn't want to kill. So yeah, Hashem wants us to kill them. It's too much. We can't handle it. And they moved to Yavne. What happened later? Came Titus, the Romans came and destroyed the Beit HaMikdash. And he wanted to kill all of them. He wanted to kill all the Chachamim. So what happened? Rabbi Yochanan ben Zakkai was the president in Israel. Rabbi Yochanan, he was a student of Hillel HaZaken. Hillel HaZaken, the Gemara say, had 80 students. 80. And the biggest one was Yonatan ben Uziel. He buried in Amuka, in the north. Never got married. Learned Torah all his life. Didn't want to waste a minute. And that's why they say, if you go to his grave and you pray there, there's Gula to get a wife or a husband. Sgula l'shiduch. I know a few people who did it and they really got married. I always said the best gula is to be tzaddik and to learn Torah and to give tzedakah, that's it. All the sgulot, whatever. But he was, the Gemara said when he was learning Torah, so holy that birds were falling around him, burned from his energy, from his fire. That's how holy he was. And the smallest one from the 80 students was Rabban Yochanan ben Zakkai, that became the president of Israel, and he lived 120 years, full life. And the Gemara say he knew the language of the angels, he knew the language of the trees, he knew the communications of the rivers, he knew the language of the animals, just like Shlomo HaMelech almost. And he was the smallest from the 80 students that Hillel HaZaken was. So I want to ask you a question. Hillel HaZaken, the Gemara said, was very, very poor. Very, very poor. He used to go every day, half a day, he used to chop trees. He takes the trees on his back and bring them to the yeshiva. Because in the old days, they didn't beg people to come learn Torah. People begged to come learn Torah. So they charged money to come to learn. So you had to pay to come into the yeshiva to learn. It wasn't for free. The yeshiva has expenses. So Hillel didn't have money to pay. He wanted to come to learn. Who was the chief rabbis? Two converts. Two goyim that converted and became very big chachamim. Who were they? Shmaya ve'Avtalion. They were the big chief rabbis in those days. And Hillel, which later became the president of the Sanhedrin, which he was the rabbi of Yonatan ben Uziel, just imagine how big these two converts were. Converts, goy, he grew up a goy with no Torah, no Hashem, no nothing. He became a legend. So both of them, they are the teacher of the biggest rabbis in history. Think about what's going on here. So now, this Hillel, take all the rabbis in the world combined, they are not 1% from this Hillel, all of them combined. He went with an axe and chopped trees like a slave in Africa. And he goes like this, here, I want to go in to learn Torah. Not like today, Mercedes, this, that. First class, $10,000 a ticket. you know, he brings his wife, 2 children, 2 servants, $50,000 first class. Who pays? Who? You. Who pays? The fools pays. The fools. They see that he fly first class, and they continue to send him money. They see that he live like a peacock. Vacations, this, that. And they continue to send money. So what do you complain? No? You know the story I once told you about the Rosh Yeshiva, that his wife told him, why you don't fly first class? You remember that story or no? If you remember, I won't say it, but you got the point. He started to want first class, first class. Just now when I went to give a lecture in Brooklyn, so a father of a very good friend of mine brought me a bag full of tefillin that I ordered from him from Yerushalayim. So he came now, he arrived yesterday, but I wasn't here, I just arrived today. So I said, I'm already in Yeshiva here in Brooklyn, it's an opportunity, let me go to his house to get the tefillin from him. He was a very old man, 82, 86, something like that, that's his age. So I went up to see him. He was laying there in bed, knock on the door, I walk in, I look around, I see him like this, like a baby in his bed. So he told me on the phone, if you come and I'm not answering, that means I fall asleep. Take this medication, it makes me fall asleep. So I went there, you know, we see it, we love each other very much. It's an opportunity, mitzvah from the Torah. Every time you visit a person that is older than 7 years old, man, old man, even if he's healthy, it's considered bikur cholim, mitzvah deoraita, to visit the sick person. Every person from 70 and up, he has the status of a sick man. Should remember that. No, bikur cholim is also to the reshaim. What can we do? We pray for them to do tshuva.
So we can still visit them.
Yeah, so anyway, I went there, we talked. So now he said, I asked him, how do you manage in flying? He just came from Israel. He has to have at least one suitcase. And he said, the way he looks, he probably cannot pick up a 5-pound bag. I said to him, how you manage? He said, no, they got for me, his sons, they got for me first class. First class. So they do everything for you. They take me this, pick me up. So he said that everyone is sleeping, you know, in first class they have beds, but he was the only one who sits. So he said, one lady came to him, she said, sir, why don't you open the bed? So he told her, my back hurts. So I told him, isn't it a shame to spend so much money when you can't even use the bed? You can't use the bed, but you need to pay $6,000, $7,000, $8,000 a ticket. Instead of 1,000. The only reason people do it, because they want the bed mainly. He cannot use the bed, he sits. Amazing. Anyway, so Rabbi Yochanan ben Zakkai, he knew all the language, everything. Now Hillel was the biggest chacham, he was the rabbi of the 80 chachamim, and he was bringing wood into the Beit HaMidrash. One time the Gemara says, there was a big snowstorm in the north of Israel. You have storms of snow sometimes. And he couldn't chop trees. Snow up to here, how can he chop trees? So he came to Beit HaMidrash. Imagine such a chacham, he comes, and the guard. So Rabbi, I'm very sorry, you know, I'm only working here. Cannot let you in. He said, but today, you know, I cannot bring trees. They used to use the trees to heat the place. I can't bring trees today. So I'm very sorry, I cannot let you in. So he went up to the roof of the building and he put his head inside the chimney over there. All night he was listening. Then Shabbat already, he went into Shabbat already. Shmaya and Aftalion was teaching and the Beit Midrash got dark in the morning. They saw there's no light today. But they look up. They see the hole that usually the sun comes from, it's blocked. They see it looks like a face of a person. They went up, they cleaned the snow, and they saw he's about to die already. He's frozen to death almost. Hillel, Hillel HaZaken, was an old man. So the Gemara say, they say, this tzaddik deserve that we, the two chief rabbis of the world, will violate Shabbat to save his life. It's mitzvah. But not by one of the students. We will do. They took him, they turned the fire on Shabbat to warm him up, and they saved his life. One time the Gemara say, in the middle of the day, he ran home. He ran home. So his student followed him. So if the rabbi left quickly like this, he's running, he's probably busy with a big mitzvah. So they ran after him. They saw he went home in the middle of the day. Then he comes out. Rabbi, what mitzvah you went to do at home in the middle of the day? Teach us. He said, I went to take a shower. Many religious people don't know that to take a shower it's mitzvah. Because if you're not clean, if you smell, especially in the summertime, when it's not so comfortable to smell, people who sweat a lot, that's automatically chilul Hashem. Chilul Hashem. You have to be very sensitive about chilul Hashem. Even if the whole world is doing it, doesn't mean you as a Jew can do it. You know, whenever you go, like in New York, people cross the street. So once the cars are gone, there's nothing to do. Everyone crosses the street, especially in Manhattan, in front of you, they jump into the street. Same thing in Yerushalayim. You come to drive, a woman, babies, stroller, jumped in front of the car. You gotta be extra, extra alert. There's no rules. It's like a zoo, the streets. Everyone walks. You go in Geula over there, thousands of people walking the street. Very, very dangerous. But when I went to Belgium now, Antwerp, we walk in the street, so cars are passing. That's it. Now the street is quiet. So I see all of them, they stand like this. Street is dead. No, not one car. There's a little, you know, maybe 10 steps, you cross the street, small street. Everyone stand like this. I was about to walk. So I see everyone is standing. So I say, why are you standing? Let's go. I say, red light. I say, hey, there's no cars, nothing. Street is empty. So I go in looking. Chilul Hashem. The goyim are looking. They say, very interesting. How they makpid on this over there. Nobody crossed the street. Nobody. And another group showed up. They also stand. Amazing. So, the fourth bracha, they did it in Yavne. When the Romans came, they went out to destroy Beit HaMikdash. They want to kill all the rabbis, all the chachamim. So what happened? 3 years they made an ambush around Jerusalem, around the wall of Jerusalem, 3 years. Nobody, there's like a siege. Nobody can come in, nobody can go out. Only funerals go out. After 3 years, Rabbi Yochanan ben Zakkai wanted to surrender. That's it, there was no more food left. 3 years, the three millionaires that had lots of food, they gave to everyone for free food for 3 years. It was Kalba Savua, Nakdimon Ben Gurion, and Ish Tzitzit Keset. 3 millionaires that had lots of food storages. For 3 years, in the time of the siege, they fed everyone for free. Everyone came, they used to give them just that the people won't die. But after 3 years, that's it, there was nothing to eat. And the Romans didn't want to have casualties because there's a very thick wall around Jerusalem. They didn't want to go to a war. It's bow and arrow, you know, they shoot from inside, they can kill a lot of them. It's very hard to climb on a wall. So what happened? After 3 years, the Jews wanted to surrender. Now why? They used to send the bodies, everyone who died in those 3 years, they send them out from the wall. Why? Because they didn't bury anyone in Jerusalem. Because you don't want graves in Jerusalem, because it becomes like a cemetery. And there's a Kohanim who goes into Beit HaMikdash. These Kohanim become impure if there's graves. So all the dead people, they send out of the wall, around the wall, beyond the wall. So what happened? Rabbi Yochanan ben Zakkai had a nephew that was the head of the gangster. He was in charge of all the Jewish gangsters. And he said to them, he called him up, his name was Abba Sikra. So he said to him, I want to go surrender to the Romans before everyone will die from starvation here. Help me out. Why he needed his help? Because the Jewish gangster, they were standing by the doors, by the gates of the wall, from inside. The Romans were from the outside, the Jews were from the inside. What are they doing? They're making sure nobody will go to surrender. They don't let Jews go out, because if the Jews go out and surrender, the Romans will come in. So they don't let anyone out. So he said, I want to go out. Make sure that you find me a way out. He said, the only way I can get you out if you pretend you're dead. If you pretend you're dead, then I can let you out. He said, okay, I'll pretend I'm dead. But it has to be real. Everyone in Jerusalem have to believe that you died. And you take your students to carry your body, because the body of a dead man is heavier than the body of a living person. Because there's no soul who push up. Once the soul comes out, the body is a little bit heavier. So make sure you take students that will know the secret that you're not dead, that nobody else would realize. Put a dead rat in your bed that will smell, and then go. So when they came out of the wall, the gangster, they have their spears. So they said, what happened? They said, the chief rabbi of Israel passed away. Let us go with his funeral. So one of the gangsters say, let me give him a punch. Let's see if he's really dead. So Abba Sikra is his nephew. They don't know it, that they're relatives. Let's see, this is a holy rabbi and this is a gangster. They didn't see connection. So he come and say to his soldiers, to his gangsters, hey, what's wrong with you? You want to punch the rabbi? What's the Romans will say, what kind of people we are? We punch the body of a rabbi. Let the rabbi goes out. So one of them say, you know what? Let me make a hole, a small hole in his stomach. You know, nobody would see. Let me make a hole just to make sure he's really dead. So he say to him, shame on you. You want to make a hole in the body of a rabbi? Let him out. So they let him out. So he came out. He wasn't dead. So he got up. Now he went to the Caesar. So he told him, Shalom Adoni HaMelech. Hello, Your Majesty. But it was only a Caesar. The king was in Rome. So the king told him, now you need to get double execution. Two, not one. One is that you just called me the king and you disrespected the real king in Rome. And for that it's death, for disrespecting the king of the biggest empire in the world. And if you think that I'm a king, you made me as a king wait for you 3 years until you come to surrender. So now you have double reason why I should kill you. So he told him, I wanted to come, but the gangster didn't let. They closed the gate. And I know you're going to be a king very shortly. So he said to him, how do you know I'm going to be the king? So he told him, HaKadosh Baruch Hu never puts the Jewish nation in the hands of a loser, of a nobody. Never. Only in the hand of the biggest empire in the world. The Philistines, the Babylonians, the Greeks, the Persians. Was never another country. Always the empire that were in charge of the world, they are the only one that Hashem put us in their hands. Not in a small nation. Always the biggest empire. Since you already came and you, the one from Shamayim that was sent here to destroy the Beit HaMikdash and to send us whatever the problems that we deserve, for sure you're going to be the king. You have to be somebody important. As they speak, a soldier from Rome came on a horse and say, Mazal Tov, you were chosen to be the new Caesar. The king of Rome died and they're calling you back to Rome to be the king. So he was amazed, how this rabbi giving me this prophecy and the soldier just arrived. So while he heard the message, he was wearing his shoes. So one shoe was already on his leg. He was about to put the second shoe, the shoe doesn't fit. So he said, I don't understand, I'm wearing these shoes every day. Well, all of a sudden, this shoe doesn't fit. So Rabbi Yochanan told him, it's only because you got a good rumor now, your bones expand. Because there's a verse in the Torah, Shemua Tova Tedashen Garem. Good news makes the bone expand a little bit, by a few millimeters. Very interesting. So now, if you want the shoe to fit, go and look in the face of one of the soldiers that you hate. After you stare at him 5 seconds, it will shrink back. So he went to one of the soldiers. He looked at him like this. Oh, it fit in. Now, that's it. The king of Rome is a body with Yochanan ben Zakkai. So he told him, okay, I owe you a lot, obviously. Tell me what you want me to do for you. So he told him three things. He didn't tell him don't destroy Beit HaMikdash because he knew the only reason they came is for that. You want too much, you get nothing in the end. So he told him, I want you not to kill Rabban Gamliel and his family. Why? Because they didn't know that Rabban Gamliel is the children of David HaMelech. It's descendants of King David. Because you know, one day Mashiach has to come from this family. So he thought that's his friends. He liked them. Okay, I don't kill Rabban Gamliel and his family. No, fine. What else do you want? He said, there's one tzaddik, his name is Rabbi Tzadok. He's already 3 years fasting, nonstop. His stomach became like a piece of paper. He's about to die any minute. Your doctors, they have all these formulas that they make, and they can cure his stomach slowly, slowly. Take care of him. Take him to your doctors, make them cure him. Consider it done. What else do you want? He told him, don't touch the yeshiva there in Yavne. There's rabbis learning Torah over there, don't touch them. So he thought, what's this yeshiva? Also his friends, maybe that's where he learns. Okay, we don't touch Yavne. Rabbi Akiva, when he heard that, Rabbi Akiva said, why he didn't ask not to destroy Beit HaMikdash? So the Chachamim explained, because he knew, he's going to say, don't destroy Beit HaMikdash. He's going to say to him, are you normal? We came with thousands of soldiers. We're waiting here 3 years for this moment to destroy it. Now you tell me don't destroy it? Ask something reasonable. So thanks to him, we have a chance to have Mashiach. And thanks to him, Sanhedrin stayed. There was Sanhedrin. The only problem is, why do you need Sanhedrin so much after the temple was destroyed? Anyway, there's no more execution. No. So only for the laws. There, by the way, you should know, when Napoleon came to Israel, Napoleon, when was that? 250 years ago, approximately? So he saw the Jews all over Israel in the shul, sitting on the floor and crying. There was Tisha B'Av that day. So he asked the soldiers there, why the Jews are crying today? What happened to them? He said, their temple was destroyed. So he said to him, when? Yesterday? He said, no, 1800 years ago. So he said, what? 1800 years ago? And now they remember to cry. He said, no, they cry every day, every year. Oh, it's a memorial. Every year they cry. So he said, a nation like this that remember his past has a future. So Napoleon offered the rabbis to renew the Sanhedrin. He offered them to gather 71 chachamim and make Sanhedrin again. Some of the rabbis agreed, and some were against it. So there was a big machloket between the chachamim, if to do or not to do, or to wait for Mashiach when he comes. So in the end, they didn't do it. What do you think? It's good that they didn't do it, or it's bad? If they made Sanhedrin 250 years ago, you think it would be good or no?
What's the use? We're in exile anyway.
I'll tell you what we would gain by that. If it's good or not, only Hashem knows. It's hard to know because too many thousands of details here. But one great thing we already lost, for sure, I can tell you. You know what? I'll tell you what. If they would renew Sanhedrin 250 years ago, you would have only one nosach of tefillah. You wouldn't have Hasidish, Litvish, Yemenite, Sfaradi. It would be one. And all the halachot would be one. One halacha. Not according to this. What are you? Ashkenazi? Oh, you allowed. What are you? Yemenite? No, you're not allowed. What are you? Wouldn't be tribes. It would be one halacha. Everything. Same custom, same halacha. Why? Because Sanhedrin, they argue with each other. In the end, they reach a decision. That was the whole idea here. That's why there's 71, that is always going to be a majority. Today, since there's no Sanhedrin, every rabbi is the rabbi of his territory. And the Torah says you have to go by the rabbi of the place. But if you put all the rabbis in one place, biggest chachamim gathered together, that's when the Torah meant, acharei rabim la'atot, follow the majority, when they are face to face. You can only follow the majority when you know that all the chachamim saw each other and were able to ask questions and answer from each other. If one was in Japan, one was in China, and one was in Israel, with no telephone, no communication, one did not see what the other one has to say. Today, with the technology that we have today, we know. But in the old days, they just couldn't see each other. That's why one thing we already lost. Imagine the world today when there was a custom for everyone the same. Everyone dressed the same. Everyone speak the same. Everyone have everything the same. You know what would be? The only difference would be the food. Still be ashpolo, gefilte fish. Still be like this. Because people, you know, they like to eat according to where they live. But halakha and customs will be one. By the way, the Israeli army had a problem. When they started to, you know, to form the army, they saw that there's different customs, Sfaradi, Ashkenazi. Now, there's one synagogue, one. And the synagogue doesn't have the rules of the place. Like over here, it's an Ashkenazi synagogue. Even though the majority of the people who pray on Shabbat are Sfaradim. But since this place is, I don't know, 50, 60, 100 years, whatever this place exists, there was always an Ashkenaz minyan. As long as there's few Ashkenazim here, it's always going to be their custom. You don't come and say, oh, let's rule it over now. It doesn't work that way. It's the custom of the place. Same thing when they come to Sfaradi, you go by the custom of the place. You go by the Hasidim, you go by their custom. That's the rule. But imagine if it would be what happened in Israeli army. They saw that one soldier comes, he speaks like Ashkenazi. Isgadal, Viskadash. Then the other one, Moroccan. The other one, Yemenite. That's the price we pay for the exile. The price that we pay for not being righteous and losing the temple, and the Goyim kicked us out of the land, and Hashem spread us in all the nations, as the prophecy said. And after 2,000 years, we all came. One Jew is like Chinese, one Jew is like Japanese, one is like Persian, one is like Bukhari. Every Jew looks like a different Goy. Even in their faces, they look like the people of the place. Some Jews look Scandinavian. Some look German. Some look Arabs. Some look like all the nations. That's the curse that we got from not listening to Hashem. It's not a privilege that we have different customs and delicious food. One person told me, wow, we the Jewish nation have the richest menu in the kitchen. We have this, Hungarian, Bukharian, this, that. So much food. Every nation have their own food. That's it. I say, you fool. That's a curse. It's not a gift. That's the results of us being like dogs running around looking for a place to sleep. We got kicked out of our land. So we sleep here, we move there, move to Afghanistan. Even in China, you have Jews. Everywhere. How many Jews in Afghanistan now, you know? No, there used to be two. One died. There's one only. Gabi, maybe you go back. You save the place. Now I was in Belgium. I went to speak in a Portuguese shul by the stock market, the diamond district of Antwerp. There's an old, ancient shul. You go inside, breathtaking. It was built 100 years ago by the Mizrahi family, Portuguese. They have their names on the wall. And now they have the 100-year anniversary. 100 years old, exactly, in May. You look at the place, they still have the original chairs, the original wood chairs from 100 years ago. The floor, little bricks like this, very small, with all kinds of shapes, all the arches inside. Amazing. You come inside, you feel history in the place. That's when the Arabs, Abu Nidal, Imach Shimo, in the 1980s, put a bomb there and killed a few people that were outside. And then there was a period that there's no minyan there, and the government wanted to make it a museum. But then, thanks to the Georgian Jews, who revived the place, today it's a very good shul. So they took it back. If the Jews would give it up, it would become a museum. That's it. But history, history. So we move on. So the conclusion of this whole thing, that they really didn't kill Yavne. They left Yavne, and the Chachamim stayed in Yavne. And in Yavne, they made the fourth bracha of Birkat Hamazon. This is what we say. Ken atov ha-metiv lakol, shebechol yom vayom, hu etiv lanu, hu metiv lanu, hu etiv. This bracha, next time when you do Birkat Hamazon, remember, we have Moshe, יהושע, דוד ושלמה, and אנשי הכנסת הגדולה, sitting where? Sanhedrin, I'm sorry, that's sitting where? In Yavne. Okay, now the Gemara says, why did they make this bracha? Moshe made it for the man. יהושע for the land. David for Yerushalayim. Shlomo for Bet HaMikdash. What is the meaning of this bracha? Tov ve'ametiv lakol, shebechol yom vayor. What's the connection? The answer is, because after the Romans slaughtered and butchered all the people of the city of Betar, some say tens of thousands of people, some say hundreds of thousands of people, one thing everyone agree, that the streets of Betar was like rivers, rivers of blood. You know when they have flood sometimes here, 3 days rain, and you look at the sewer and you see tons of water are flooding all over the street, going down to the, there's so much water, it doesn't go into the sewer. Such an amount of water, that's how it was, but with blood. And then what they did, after they killed all of them, they took their bodies, and they used their bodies as a fence. They wanted to surround an area, so they took one person, they put another body, and then they made fences with the body. They used the bodies like we use wood. And one of the miracles that Hashem did is that the bodies did not smell. Do you know what happened if a body stay in a sunny day, 24 hours? Do you know the smell of it? There's no way to enter the house. That's, by the way, why Yom Kippur and Shabbat will never be attached. What's the connection? Because in the old days, there were no refrigerator. You don't put the body in a refrigerator. What happened if a person died in the middle of Shabbat? Fall on the floor, heart attack. He's dead now. Cannot move his body. It's mukzeh. So if he died Friday night, and we're not talking New York that it's cold here. We're talking Israel now, very hot. Even in the winter it's hot. So what happened now? There's a body in a hot weather, in the middle of a living room. People have to sit and do Shabbat, and they cover him with a blanket or something. And they begin to smell the body after a few hours. Now what happened if Yom Kippur will be Sunday? So from Shabbat you go right into Yom Kippur. So now 48 hours, Yom Kippur, you have to fast and you cannot breathe. You have to go and live in the street. What are you going to do? So Hillel, which Hillel? Not Hillel HaZaken, his grandson. Hillel made the Jewish calendar. I always say if you learn about the Jewish calendar, it's enough to become religious right away. You don't need proofs. You see right away it's not human. He planned all the future mathematically, how the holidays, and Rosh Chodesh, everything will be always perfect. One of the things he calculated is that Shabbat and Yom Kippur will never be attached. Yom Kippur can fall on Shabbat, but never on Friday and never on Sunday. You believe such thing? No, show me a mathematician that can do such thing. And that's it. Until today, 1800 years later, it never falls on Friday and it never falls on Sunday. Why? That it won't be 2 days like strict Shabbat. Now you may tell me, but on holidays we have 2 days. Yom Tov in Chutz Laaretz, right? 2 days Pesach. 2 days. So the answer is, Yom Tov is not as strict as Shabbat. It's lenient. In the first Yom Tov, Shabbat you're not allowed to bury a body. First Yom Tov you're allowed to bury a Jew by using a goyim. Mustafa, come, we have a dead person, lo aleinu, come take him and bury him. First day, Mustafa or Ahmed, they'll do the job. But the second day, even the Jews can do it. Second day of Yom Tov, the Jews can do the funeral themselves. Why? Because the second day is rabbinical. First day is from the Torah, second day is Gzirah de Rabbanan. So Rabbanan, when they made a decree, they made sure not to torture people. They didn't make a decree to make us suffer in Yom Tov. They make the decrees to help us. So במקום של צער לא גזרו. So since it's a tzar to see the body is laying there for 2 days, second day the Jew himself can go and bury him in the ground. So in Yom Tov there's no problem, because he can be buried first day, he can be buried second day. Shabbat cannot be buried. Same thing Yom Kippur, so therefore Yom Kippur will never be attached. So why they made this bracha tov ve'ametiv? Because after 3 years that the body were laying there, think about it, think about what's going on here. Which bodies? Which? The body of the rabbi, the body of his wife, the body of this rabbi, the body of the mayor of the city, the body of all the other people who learn Torah. You walk in the street, for those who survived, imagine what it is. You have to see the chief rabbi's body as a fence. There's nothing you can do. You move it or something, it'll kill you and your whole family. 3 years like this. What a torture. 3 years to walk around and to see so many bodies all over. So after 3 years, these cruel Romans finally gave permission to bury the victims of the genocide that they did in Beitar, and they finally buried them. So that day, they made this bracha. So why they call the bracha Hatov ve'ametiv? You should just say ametiv. Metiv means benefits. Tov means the good, who benefits. Hatov ve'ametiv. Why two words? The Gemara say Hatov, that they did not smell. They didn't smell bad. Ve'ametiv, that they finally got buried, and the soul never have rest until the body is buried. You should know it. That's why those who burned their parents and put them on the shelf. One time I went to someone's house. I look at the pictures on the shelf, and he said, "No, do you like my father?" I look around. I see pictures of children. Who's your father? I look around. Face in a jar. I look in the jar. I see ashes there inside. It's like sand. Say, yeah, it's my body's. How do you call it? Criminated him? Crimination, whatever. Amar Rabbi Yochanan, kol amvarech al kos male, when you do fill up the glass with wine, notnim lo nachala belo metzarim. I don't know if it applies anymore today. Why? Because in the old days, it was very difficult to reach wine, to make wine. It was all handmade. You have to get the grapes, cut, everything manual. You have your with your legs, you smash them, you clean, and you put it in barrels. It's a lot of headache. That's why wine was a very, very hard thing to get. It wasn't like today, you go, you pay $4, you have right away 2 liters of wine, it's enough for 2 months. Different world. That's why people, it was very hard for them to have wine for Kiddush and wine for Avdalah. Many people couldn't afford it. So it was a matter of emunah. If you have faith in Hashem or not, because it's hard to get. So the Gemara say, if you go after the wine, you're not being cheap, it's hard to get, or it's too much to prepare it yourself, then you get this endless blessing from Hashem. Why? It's a significant proof that you are a believer. I always say to someone, you want to have a good believer as your son-in-law? You want your daughter to marry a believer? Send him to do shopping for Shabbat in a supermarket and follow him. So he asked me, what's the connection? I said, the Gemara said that all the food that we buy for Shabbat is not coming from our pocket. It's all on Hashem's credit card. Doesn't come from our pocket. Whatever, if Hashem wanted you to have $50,000 budget this year, everything you buy, lichvot Shabbat Kodesh, doesn't come from your pocket. So you bought a suit, you have to always make sure, I'm teaching you a very good trick now, to double your income, right away, without going to accounting school, 8 years. No $300 an appointment, no. Here, free. You want to double your income? Make sure you do it this. A, whenever you buy a suit, for you, for your wife, for your children, don't ever wear it on a weekday. First wear it, first time, on Shabbat or Yom Tov. And you say when you buy it, Lichvot Shabbat Kodesh. And at least in the first time, at least once, you wear it on Shabbat. Then you move it to weekdays, whatever you want to do with that. But first time, if you do it like this, everything you buy would not come out of your budget. If you don't do it like this, you're supposed to make 50,000 and you bought 5 suits this year, so now it became 48,000. It comes from you. Same thing, food. You buy food for Tuesday, for Wednesday, from the supermarket, and now whatever you have, you use for Shabbat, it comes from your budget. But if you go Thursday or Friday and you fill up the cart, And he said, what's this? This for Shabbat, the fruits for Shabbat, the meat for Shabbat. And he said, lichvot Shabbat, it doesn't come from your budget. It's a big thing, big relief. Also, the yeshivot of your children. There's no point of sending them to public school because the yeshivot are for free. I know, he's smiling. Because that's what we hear. We hear people complain. Why the yeshivot are so expensive? I got to tell you something. Really, if you really think about it, even if the yeshiva charge $1,000 a kid for a month, it's still cheap. We don't make money because Uncle Sam is taking advantage on us. But really, $1,000 is not enough, and I tell you why. They go to the yeshiva 7, 8 in the morning until 10 o'clock at night. How many hours a day? 13, 14 hours a day. Multiply by 24 days a month, at least, take Shabbat out. 24 multiply by, let's say, 10. It's 240 hours, but it's really more. It's almost 300 hours. So if it's 300 hours and it's $1,000 a month, how much you pay an hour? $3 an hour. No, it's a lot that the Rebbe will teach your son Torah free for $3 an hour. It's not a lot. And if it's $2,000 a month, it's $6 an hour. What's better? You send them to public school, they teach them to be murderers and to come with a knife and have a metal detector, and every 2 days you need drug test over there. That's what you want to send your kids? I always say, without any hesitations, without any doubt, if you don't trust Hashem to give you the money for the yeshivot, and you want to send your kids to public school, keep them at home. Don't send them to any school. Better. Just keep them at home. When they be 14, find them a job. Quietly put them somewhere to work. Much, much better than to send them to public school. They don't need public school. Most of the kids who went to public school became enemies of Hashem. Don't keep Torah, don't keep mitzvot, and don't give me a proof of few good kids that naturally are good and tzaddikim, so they went to public school and they ended up Shomer Shabbat. Because for everyone like this you show me, I'll show you 999 that marry Goyim in the end. Thanks to this public school saving. So don't show me the one, show me the 999. You know that I'm not exaggerating. You know what's happening there, no? Right or wrong? Right? That's it. Then, who does Birkat HaGomel? That's a famous question. Everybody asked it. Rabbi, my car slid and I almost made an accident. Do I have to make Birkat HaGomel? Oh, Rabbi, my car hit another car. It was a big accident. Nothing happened to me. Do I have to do Birkat HaGomel? Rabbi, the doctor thought I have a cancer. The next day he called and said I made a mistake. It wasn't cancer. It was an infection. Do I have to make Birkat HaGomel? All kinds of things. Rabbi, I was supposed to marry this woman and she dumped me 2 weeks before the wedding. And now she went and married someone else for 10 years and I just found out she's barren. She can never have kids. So I got so lucky. Because now I got married and I have children. Then I would be with her, I wouldn't have children. So do I have to make Birkat HaGomel? There's a lot of questions, no? So who has to make Birkat HaGomel? People who went on a boat in the ocean. No, in the old days the boat goes, not like today, you have the Titanic, which is so safe. If the Titanic drowned, when it was such a supposedly safe with engines and all kinds of things, imagine the boats of 800, 900 years ago was all handmade, all pieces of wood with some tar and some, you know, pieces of material and depend on the wind. There's no engine. No engine. If there's no wind, 4 days you sit in the middle of the ocean waiting for Eliyahu Navi to come. What are you doing? Well, learn Gemara. What are we doing in the middle of the ocean? We're waiting for the wind to move us. There's nothing you can do. Or they had 50 people, sailors. They go like this. Yes, it's a very hard life. So to cross the ocean could take months. To make it safe, what a miracle. So you have to do Birkat HaGomel. Especially when they used to be pirates. Robbers. They come, pirates, whatever you call them. They come in the middle of the night, they attack you. Oh, all of a sudden, they rob you in the middle of the ocean, they take everything and they go away. What can you do? There's nothing to eat now. So there was a lot of danger. So somebody like that has to say Birkat HaGomel. Someone who crossed the desert, same thing, on a camel, 3 months in the Sahara Desert, you know, to find a direction, need a compass, maybe it's going to take you by mistake to Bin Laden. In the end, oh, Baruch Hashem, I see Yerushalayim from far. That you did it, now you have to do Birkat HaGomel. Someone that was sick and went to hospital for at least 3 days. 3 days he was laying in bed. He couldn't function for 3 days at least and more. Then he has to do it. And someone who went to jail. Someone was arrested. 1 week, 1 year, whatever it was. They make Birkat HaGomel. And that's it. Now, why we make Birkat HaGomel when we go with the planes to Israel, to LA? Because we either cross the ocean, so crossing the ocean, even though it's much, much safer than before. But still, say, crossing the ocean and crossing the desert. And that's why we make Birkat HaMazon. But not every flight you have to do Birkat HaMazon. Birkat HaGomel. So, you know, so what's happening here, you should know that it's not so simple. Some poskim say you don't say brachot. HaGomel on flights and things like this. Technically, even though every once in a while we hear that a plane crash and we get goosebumps all over the body, what a way to die, to crash with a plane, technically it's 1,000 times safer than a car. Statistically, the chance that when you get on a plane, right, or if you be in a car driving 8 hours, or if you be on a plane, in a car it's much, much more dangerous. So many dangers in a car, even more than the plane. Even though it looks like the plane, wow, what a miracle that he finds his way and with all the equipment that they have, it's technically safer. Not if it's Air India or something like this. Maybe the Maharaja smoke a little bit too much. My mistake, he put the wrong computer over there. I don't know. But if they, you know, now there's a big strike in Israel, in the airport, you know. Yeah, because now, huh? נגמר? מה קרה? מה, עם אלעל? I was wondering, I saw on my flight today, this morning, the chief rabbi of Israel was on my plane, Rabbi Matzger, in Antwerp. So I was thinking to myself, why is he there? Probably there's a strike in Israel, he couldn't come directly to New York, he had to come through Antwerp, or he was there for Shabbat, one of the two. It's finished, the strike. Baruch Hashem. Then the Gemara says like this, 3 things make the life of a person shorter. So if you want to die young, do it. These are the ones. If they call you up to the Torah and you don't, they say Aliyah, they call you and say, no, no, I don't want. Usually white people don't want Aliyah. They're embarrassed. Either Aliyah to the Torah. You go up to the Torah when they read, they have 7 olim on Shabbat and maftir. Usually, it doesn't apply to women, it applies only to men. So, if he calls you, usually people don't want, because either they don't know how to read the brachot, or even if they know how to read the brachot, they're embarrassed that everyone looks at them, not everyone likes attention. Or it's a person, no, he's a sinner. And he said, I'm not worthy of going up next to the Torah. There's all kinds of reasons. But I want to relax you. It's only if they call your name, like the Ashkenazim do. The Ashkenazim say, Amod, Yosef ben David. Once they say your name, you're not allowed to refuse. By the Sfaradim, even though not all of them follow the tradition of the Sfaradim, by the Sfaradim, you're not supposed to say the name. You just say, Ya'amod. You say, Shlishi, Aole, Aale, Bechavod, the third one. You say it by number, third one, fourth one, fifth one. You don't say name. Only later you make Mishaberach, you say his name. So if that's the case, and he did not say your name, you can refuse. But if he said your name, you go up. If They give you a glass of wine to make bracha, birkat hamazon, zimun, and you refuse. The same thing. Someone who pretends he's a rabbi, but he knows he doesn't know Torah, he just pretends because he wants money or respect or whatever he wants. All of that we learn from different verses in the Torah, that if a person does it, God forbid, his life shorter. The Gemara say like this, if the Gemara wouldn't say it, I would never dare to say it, but I'm reading it to you. From Gemara in Masechet Brachot, the Gemara say, Amar Rabbi Chama Bar Chanina, Mipnei ma met Yosef kodem echav. Why Yosef HaTzadik, Yosef, died the youngest out of all the brothers. He died 110, they all live longer. He had the shortest life. Yosef HaTzadik. Why? Mipnei shehinhig atzmo barabanut. Because he wanted to be in charge, wanted to be a rabbi. Because of that, his life was shorter than the others. Hard to believe. The Gemara says like this. Every time you nominate a person to be in charge of the public, you have to consult with the public first if they like this person. Even if you know this person is very talented, very smart, very good, and he can do a lot from the community, if he has enemies in a community, you do not nominate him. Where do we learn it from in the Torah? Where do we learn it? The Gemara say, Vayomer, it says like this, Vayomer Moshe el Bnei Israel, Re'u, קרא השם בשם בצלל. השם told me, בצלל בן אורי, it's the best one to build the משכן. אמר לו הקדוש ברוך הוא למשה, משה, השם say to משה, you agree with my nomination to make בצלל the one in charge of building the משכן? אמר לו ריבונו של עולם, משה said, השם, if he's worthy for you, he won't be worthy for me. אמר לו, השם say, even though, go and ask the nation of Israel if it's okay with them. He asked them, would you agree to take Bezalel as the leader? They all said, yes. It's good for you and for Hashem. It's not going to be good for us. So which means if they say no, he wouldn't make him. That's why when you want someone to pray in Yom Kippur, if people hate him from the shul, because he has personality issues, or you owe money to people and he doesn't pay on time, all kinds of things like this, don't make him the Shliach Tzibur. People stand there, they get angry the entire Yom Kippur. Why is it? Okay, now, the Gemara says, Amar Rabbi Yochanan, Ena Kadosh Baruch Hu noten chokma, Ela lemi sheyesh bo chokma. Hashem give wisdom to wise people. Why? It's not fair. He should give wisdom to foolish people. The wise people are wise already. Take the phlegmat here and give him some wisdom. That he doesn't have sechel. He has sechel. You give him more sechel? Even in the league, the basketball league, when they see a bad team, they give him the best player that comes now to balance the level of the team, no? The goyim understand they have to keep the league equal. So why Hashem give wisdom to someone who's already wise? Huh? Who knows? No, let's see who's clever here. It's a little bit deeper than what it sounds.
To teach the rest that are not wise.
Well, the ones that are not wise, believe me, some of them do want to be wise. But it's hard to be wise. No?
They appreciate it.
No?
You cannot fall down to it.
You know how they say in yeshiva, I hear you. I hear you. No?
Huh? A foolish person is too fool to be wise.
Not true. I know one foolish guy that used to learn with me in yeshiva for 3 years. His head was blocked. Every person who comes to yeshiva in 2 weeks got smarter than him. 2 weeks. It was 3 years there. You know what happened in the end? He was so persistent and devoting that in one moment Hashem opened his brain and he became a rabbi. All the things he learned, all of a sudden started to flood one after the other. Why? Hashem saw that this person not giving up and he gave it to him as a gift. It's all a matter of amal, Torah. It's not, it doesn't matter how many hours you learn. It's how do you learn. How do you learn? The more you show that you're serious, the more Hashem helps you. It's not history. You learn 2 hours, you know 5 pages. You learn 4 hours, you know 10 pages. No. Torah, you learn 4 hours, you learn 1 page of Gemara. Now you learn 8 hours, you can learn 3 pages of Gemara. Why? Because Hashem sees that you're serious, He gives you more respect, more siyata dishmaya. That's the way it is. So what's the answer? The answer is, which wise one they talk? People who worked very much to improve their wisdom, when they reach 30%, Hashem adds a lot more to their wisdom. Why? Ptach li petach kepitcho shel machat, ואפתח לך כפתחו של אולם. Open me like the size of a needle, and I open you like the whole world. Why is it? Because Hashem wants to help someone who wants to help himself. Remember this rule. If he see you sleep all day, do nothing, all day smoking, this, that, doing nothing, He won't give you wisdom, nothing. No siyata dishmaya. See, you get up early in the morning, you come to shul, you sit, you want to learn, you beg the rabbi, I want to learn with you, give me a student, come every day to the yeshiva. They say, no, we don't have room for you, come back next week, you come again. You're not giving up. Like some of these goyim that wants to convert, they go through hell until they convert in some places. But how, why is it? Because they want to check how serious they are. If he gives up after 1 minute, somebody like this can be a Jew. One little challenge in a mitzvot, or right away he gives up. That's too much for me. No, you need somebody serious. Same thing in the army. You want to be a marine. You come now. Yesterday you were in a bar in Texas. Now you came and you have to go against Bin Laden and his guerrillas. So what are you going to do? They have to prepare you. They kill you over there. They destroy you. Cold, hot, no sleeping, go run in the fire. This noise. They want to make you a monster. Why? Because you're going to fight against monsters. You need a preparation. You want to be a Jew. You came from this phony religion of yours that everything is allowed, singing a little bit hallelujah with the piano, and everything is allowed. So now you want to gum 613 laws, this. Gabi, it's dangerous. When you laugh, you're making me laugh. Okay, when you laugh, put the head down at least. Anyway, so no, really, think about it. It's very, very hard. Now, from this religion that everything is allowed, once in a while you throw 50 bucks to the father to take the sins away from you. And that's okay, you have an umbrella insurance. If the father forgot to take the sin, JC already take all the suffering. It's okay. Do whatever you want. I want to tell you a story. Let's change subject a little bit. You know, there's one rabbi, he decided to give a shiur to business people in Israeli diamond district. So he goes, he gives a lecture. There's 8 business people. So they come, they enjoy very much because he teaches them about business according to the Gemara. One day after the shiur, one of them come to the rabbi and say, Rabbi, Chazaku Baruch. So the rabbi said, I wonder why this guy compliment me. Why? Because usually he fall asleep in the middle of shiur, this guy. So he said to him, you know why I like your shiurim so much? He said, I learned from you how to be so sufficient, effective when I cheat my customers. Say, from your shiurim, I learned all these tricks you bring from the times of the Gemara, how the thieves used to be. You taught me some great ideas how to steal. He tells it to him in his face. This poor rabbi, he thought he comes to do a mitzvah. He found himself doing a sin. So now he asked the rabbi, should he continue to give the shiur? I'll tell you what's the dilemma. First of all, you have 7 against 1. 7 are serious, and they learn Torah. And this is a crook. בדרך שאדם רוצה ללך מוליכים אותו. You choose where you want to go, and Hashem helps you. That's it. In the end, you pay the price. You get punished. Hashem helps you the way you choose. So now, 7 are positive, 1 is negative. Can we say that we go by the majority and whatever happened with him happened? Or, since it's an immediate damage to people that he damaged other Jews, then we don't have permission to teach him. So we have to throw him out of the shiur, but he doesn't want to leave. So we have to do the shiur anyway with him. There's a few questions here. What do you think?
You have to save someone from sin.
We have to save someone?
You can't make a sin to save someone else from sinning.
What sin are you going to make?
Continue with the lecture.
If you could, you can never say in the world that to give a lecture is a sin. You can never say. You teach Torah, it's always a mitzvah. He learns from your Torah to do negative things that he wants to do. But the question is, because after all, in the end, the sin is done by him, and maybe I'm giving him a help indirectly, maybe I'm not allowed to teach him, and the only way is to cancel the shiur.
But it's not Rabbi's fault. It's the fault of that person. That he learns only bad from that shiur.
You can change the
location. So listen good. The Gemara say, in Masechet Sanhedrin, page 109, Rabbi Yossi, he was giving a lecture in Tzipori. It's in the north of Israel, in the Galilee. And he said that the people of Sodom and Gomorrah, the way they used to steal and rob the people, they used to make a perfume. It's called Shemen Afarsemon. Persimmons. I don't know if they mean the same persimmons that you have in L.A. in the tree and you eat. It's beautiful, delicious. Maybe that's from that they make perfume. I don't know, maybe it's from that. But it was such an amazing smell that the Gemara said that one of the Chachamim asked HaKadosh Baruch Hu, what are you going to give me in Olam Haba? And he told him 13 rivers of this oil, of this perfume. Because you know that smell, it's a pleasure to the soul, not to the body. Vision, to see colors, it's soul. To hear music, it's soul. To smell good smell, it's soul. To hear words of Torah, it's soul. To eat food is body. Smoke cigarettes is body. Sexual relationship is body. It's body and soul. It's two different pleasures. So what they used to do? They used to give it a gift to someone that they want to rob. Why? Why would the thief come to Mr. Rothschild and give him a perfume? Why? Because he knew Mr. Rothschild will put this expensive perfume where? In his safe. But the smell of it is so great that when they come, they'll know where is the treasure. That's the trick here. So they used to come at night, and by the smell, they used to locate the treasures. So that night, after Rabbi Yossi said this drasha in Tzipori, 300 safes in the city of Tzipori got robbed. That's what happened in the Gemara. After his drasha. Imagine you come, you give shiur Torah, and the next morning they tell you your shiur made a disaster in town. So the people of the city came to sue Rabbi Yossi. They say, you gave them a bad idea, because of you we all got robbed. He said to them, if I knew the thieves will come to the shiur, I would not say that. So what do we learn from his answer? That if you know there's a thief in a shiur,
you're not allowed to say. But how are you supposed to know?
So is that a proof to this rabbi that he cannot say it in front of that thief or no?
Yes.
Huh? It's a proof? I can say it's not a proof.
No, what you say.
No, I still say that it's still not a proof. It's a partial proof, but not a solid proof. Why? Maybe in Rabbi Yossi there were 300 thieves that day in the drasha. Everyone was a thief there. Over here, it's 1 against 7. Still majority. Maybe over there, the majority were thieves. After he heard that there were 300 robberies, maybe it was the same thief. Robbed 8 places. We don't know. But maybe it seems that the majority of the people in his drasha were thieves. So that's why he said, if I knew, I wouldn't say it. But maybe if the minority is thieves, maybe he would still say it. Well, let's see. The Gemara in Masechet Baba Bratra say, page 89. Amar Rabbi Yochanan ben Zakkai, Oy li im omar, oy li im lo omar. Oy if I would say, oy if I wouldn't say. How do you call it in English? Catch 22. I don't know why. Why catch 22? If I do it, I lose. If I don't do it, I also lose. But why they call it catch 22? Nobody knows. If I would say, the thief people, the thief will learn. If I won't say, the people would say that the rabbi doesn't know Torah. He couldn't teach it. So the answer is, listen good. Ki yesharim darkei Hashem, the ways of Hashem are kosher. Tzadikim yelchu bam, the righteous people will follow the guideline. Uposhiim yikashlu bam. And at the same law, a criminal, a crook, will use it to fail, to make a sin. So the Gemara say, the Ben Ishchai asked, why Rabbi Yossi say he didn't know that the thieves would come, and he didn't give the answer of Rabbi Yochanan ben Zakkai that was before him. He was the president of Israel. I told you the story about him before. So he was at least 100 years before. He should have said, Rabbi Yossi say, it's not my problem. I teach Torah. The righteous people learn. The wicked people, they make sins. With or without my Torah. Why he didn't give this? Why Rabbi Yossi say, if I knew the thieves would come, I wouldn't say. He should have not said it. He should have said, even if the thief would come, it's not my problem. I teach Torah. That's it. No, what's the answer? Looks like a contradiction. The conclusion. If you teach, even if you know there are thieves that will come and learn it, if you teach the law, you cannot move from the law. You cannot twist the law. You have to teach the law. But if you give a speech, an ethic speech, Musar, and you have to be careful if you know there are not decent people in the crowd, what to say, what not to say. Like Chazal say, there are certain laws that you're not allowed to say in front of the ignorance. Because the ignorance would misinterpret what you say and go and make horrible sins with their light brain. They see what the rabbi say and they're already gonna think, oh, that means this is allowed, this is allowed. And they make a very big mistake. We have a rule. Sometimes on Shabbat, people pray very strict. Then when the rabbi gets on a stage to give his weekly speech, they run home. Maybe the children won't be hot enough. They're afraid maybe. Maybe it will be a little bit overcooked. But they don't stay for the 10, 20 minutes that he speaks. What do you think? They have permission to leave or no? He doesn't want to stay for the drasha. He wants to go home. He can come to the rabbi and say, Rabbi, I apologize, I have an emergency. So now there's no disrespect. Can he do it or no? He doesn't have an emergency, but not to insult him. So it's called Sheker Leshem Shalom, to make him feel good, not to have a fight. So he says, I have to run, I'm very sorry, forgive me, ta-ta-ta. Or he can say to him before the tefillah, I'm going to live in the middle, so please don't get offended. It happens sometimes. The question is, if he doesn't have an emergency, And he prayed, and he wants to go. He doesn't want to stay for drasha. I came to the shul to pray. I didn't tell you to give a speech. I want to go. Allowed or not allowed? Hi, Emil, what do you say? Allowed? This is what Hashem says. המסיר אוזנו משמוע תורה, גם תפילתו תועבה. Translation. Someone who removes his ear from listening to Torah, his prayers is despicable in the eyes of God. Is it clear, or I have to make it more clear? 3 hours you pray, 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 Te'ilim, Da'at, 18, Kedusha, Birkat Kohanim. Then 10 minutes, Drasha, you run home. Hashem says, oh, you want me to accept your 3 hour prayers in your dreams. Why? You run away from my Torah, I run away from your prayers. Very simple, measure for measure. But here it doesn't say it like this. It says it like this, no? It says it in a much worse version. It says, גם תפילתו תועבה. You know what's the difference between his תפילה doesn't get accepted or his תפילה is despicable? What is the difference? Do you know? There is a difference when the boss has a worker and the worker comes to ask for a raise and the boss says, okay, I heard you, but I'm not approving your request. No hard feeling, goodbye. Go on back to work. But if the boss say to him, I'm disgusted from you, just get out of my face, I don't want to see you. It's much worse, no? Right? That's what Hashem say to someone who leaves the drasha. Your tefillah that you just pray to me, I want to vomit from you. That's called toeva. Usually when they use the word toeva, for sex crimes, for avodah zara, and for exits of bathrooms that are in the street, and a person wants to pray when he walks in the street and some dog made something on the floor, you're not allowed to say it. If you see it or if you smell it, you have to go near, far away from it. Or close your eyes. Even if it got dry and doesn't have smell, it's still you cannot look at it. So that's called toeva. And who knows where else does it say, Toeva in the Torah, that Hashem call one kind of a sinner in this world, Toeva, which means in English I think it's called despicable. Who knows?
Abomination
is the word. Abomination? Okay. Where else does it say abomination? Where?
Same relationship.
Toavat Hashem, kol gva lev. It's, now how do you say? It's despicable in the eyes of Hashem. It's, what's the word? Abomination? It's abominable? Let's go back to the despicable. It's too hard for me. Who invented this language? So, when a person is proud and has an ego, Hashem looks at him like what's inside of the bathroom before it was flushed. Now, who can raise his hand over here and say, it's not me? We're not proud. I'm the best this, I'm the best that, I'm like this, I'm like that. It's thanks to me. I did it. Anoten pat latinok tzarich leodi aleimo. Someone who gives something to a kid, he has to ask permission from his mother first. Why? One time, one guest came to my house many years ago. After that short visit, he came one meal on Shabbat morning. The life of my wife became a nightmare. Who knows why?
Candies.
He gave the little kid Coca-Cola. And from that moment on, he did not want to breastfeed anymore. Only cry for this. What an innocent mistake can cause. Plus, there's allergies. You give him some kind of a cake and it has eggs in it. I know one person is allergic to eggs. As soon as he tastes a little egg mixed in any food, his face becomes like a real balloon. Like this, right away to the hospital. Life risk. Allergies. You know that the Kurdish Jews, if they eat lima bean full, they can die on the spot. You know that? I had a guest in my house. There was rice mixed with lima beans. It was a Kurdish guy from Brooklyn. Was about to eat it already. And he said, what is this? This? My brother died. He ate it. He would eat it, he would die in my house. Full lima beans. How to know? Don't give food before you ask permission. You're allowed to, for him to. Some parents are very strict. They don't want the kids to have any candy. Nothing. Sugar, candy. Some only eat vegetarian. Some only eat natural things. There's all kinds of craziness out there. One more thing, which is a very common mistake we do. Amar Rabbi Yossi, Leolam al yiftach adam piv la satan. Don't open your mouth and call the Satan. What does it mean? That a person walk and he say, wow, what if a policeman will catch us? 2 minutes later, whee! It wouldn't happen if you wouldn't say it. What if we miss the plane? You have to be careful what comes out of your mouth, because you give ideas to the Satan. Satan is an angel, an evil angel, but still he's a robot. Hashem programmed him to do bad for us. But if you give him ideas, he sometimes reacts. Where does it say in the Gemara that what comes out of our mouth affecting the feelings of the Satan?
What if we're thinking that?
Thinking, really, thinking there's no source that is considered iftach piv la satan. But I can tell you from personal experience that even if you think negative, it can affect. But he didn't say it in the Gemara, so I cannot say it. But where does it say in the Gemara that you can hurt the feeling of the Satan? Get him very upset or very happy? Two stories in the Gemara, quick, no?
When you said it one time.
No.
When something with the...
The vidui, that's the good one. And what's the bad one?
Well, young people died.
Good. Say there, somebody remember something. Flemo, his name, Flemo. By the way, you know today, there's a massive industry about changing names today. What's your name? Oh, change your name, it's not a good name. What's your name? Oh, it's a goy name. What's your name? I never understand it. Why? If you look at the names of all the biggest rabbis in history in the time of the Gemara, it's all non-Jewish names. Flemo, it's a Jewish name. Almost all the names in the Gemara. Sumchus, it's a Jewish name. It's all kinds of names. I don't know. Don't know. Anyway, Flemo, he used to curse the Satan. May an arrow go in between the eyes of the Satan. So Satan used to get upset. So one time he came and he pretended he's a poor man and he's asking for bread, and Flemo saw that he has full of pus and leprosy. So he said, wait here, I'm going to bring you food. Wait here. It was Yom Kippur Eve, before Yom Kippur started. So he got a piece of bread to give it to him. By the time he turned around, he pretended he died in Flemo's living room. And now the Satan makes noise outside. You hear what happened? Flemo murdered his guest. People outside screaming. So from the panic, he ran and hide in the public bathroom. There was no $150,000 bathrooms in each house, like today. So he ran to hide in a public bathroom out of town. So when he got to the bathroom, Erev Yom Kippur, he's about to spend his Yom Kippur in the bathroom from the embarrassment. He sees that the poor man is in the bathroom. He says, I thought you died. You say, I'm not a person. I'm the Satan. I just fooled you. So he said, why you did this to me? You broke my heart. So he told him, you break my heart every day. I broke your heart at least once. Why you keep cursing me that an arrow will go in between my eyes? Do you think I want to do bad to people? I only do what Hashem told me to do. It's my job. I'm the Yetzer Hara, the evil inclination. That's one story. Then the second story, one person, the Satan, liked him. There's another story. The story said, Darash Levi, Pnina, and Satan meant for the sake of heaven. Pnina said to Hannah, why are you drunk? Why are you praying like this, like you're drunk? But she was crying to Hashem. So she meant well, but since she hurt her feelings, all her children died, and she later had children. Some horrible thing here. So she meant well, but that's not the story. He also said that the Satan meant well when he asked Hashem, where do you have a person like Avraham Avinu? And he said, go to Yov. He meant well. Okay. So why? The Gemara say, when there was two rabbis, one of them was Levi and the other one, he was the one who gave it to the public. So he went and kissed his feet. So the Chachamim asked, why he didn't kiss the legs of the rabbi who told the Dvar Torah to the world, only to the one who later gave it in his speech? If I write it in my book, and he gives it in his Dvar Torah tomorrow to his friend, who deserves the credit, me or him? Me, right? So why the Satan came to the person who told it to the public and kissed him, and not to the person who told the secret to the world? Should have kissed him. From here you learn the level of telling Torah to others, how great it is. You can even tell the halacha, it's nothing compared to the one who go and spread it out to the world. The one who spread it out to the world is more important, which means, if someone like Moshe Rabbeinu told you a law, and you went and made it public to the world, your level in this case is higher than him that told you the secret. Why? Because you're the one who published it. Anyway, so the Satan liked one person. So he told him, since you and I are friends and we're getting along together, I want to ask you one favor. What is it? Don't ever kill me before I do confession. Don't kill me in a heart attack or drowning. Give me enough time. Either I get sick, so give me a few days to prepare for my death. And like this, I can do confession that I die righteous. I confess for all my sins. So the Satan said, okay, deal. When your time comes to die, I'll give you enough time to do a confession. So what happened now? This guy said, oh, I fooled the Satan very good. From now on, I will never say confession ever in my life. They'll never be able to kill me. So every day when we do confession in the shul, they're all, the entire shul, chatati, aviti, pashati, and he sits over there, enjoy. What happened, Moshe? You don't make sins? No, I don't do confession. Like this, a year, 2 years, 3 years. Now the time came, the Satan wants to kill him, but he can't kill him. So the Satan decided to pretend that he's a person is dying in the middle of the road. So this person, one day walk in the street and he see a person, help, help, I'm dying, help. So he comes to him and say, hey, say, I'm dying. Do me a favor, before I die, help me to do tshuva, to make repentance. I don't know, I don't have a sidur, I don't know how to make confession, help me. So he say, okay, repeat after me. Hatati. By the time they finish the confession, he got up, he see the Satan full of eyes. Say, see how I fooled you? So I thought we buddies. He say, shame on you, 3 years I'm waiting to kill you, you fooled me with this confession. Okay, just mamash last minute or two. The Gemara says like this, every sickness, just not sickness in the stomach. Every pain, but not heartache. Every pain, physical pain, but not headache. Everything bad, just not a bad wife. So if they ask you, what's the worst? Bad wife.
What's the worst headache? What's the worst pain? Headache. What's the worst sickness? Stomach. What's the worst spiritual pain? In the heart. Broken heart, like they say in English. Broke my heart. The Gemara says like this. מעשה בתלמיד אחד ששנה הרבה וקרא הרבה. There was one תלמיד ישיבה, learning Torah, learn a lot, and help the rabbis, and work with the rabbis, and died very young. And his wife took his tefillin, and she went from one yeshiva to the other, one synagogue to the other, and said to the rabbis, where is the justice of the Torah? It says that someone who learned Torah live long life. כי הם חיינו ואורך ימינו. בעלי, my husband, that learned so much Torah, and read so much, and taught so much, and served the rabbi so much. Why did he die so young? And nobody knew what to answer her. How can it be? They knew he's learning a lot. He's every day in yeshiva. One time, it's Eliyahu Hanavi. One time I went to be a guest in her house. And I asked her about her husband and her. And she said, and I asked her, in a time that you were impure, your monthly period, how you used to behave, you and him? She said, God forbid, he didn't even touch my finger. He said, what? After that, after the 7 days, what? She said, we ate together, drink together, sleeping in the same bed. But still we did not make anything more than that. So he said, how great is Hashem that he always do exactly what he said. She said, why? He said, Hashem say, Elisha benida tumata lo tikrav legalot ervata. Woman that still did not go into the mikveh, even the blood stopped. No more blood. So technically, she doesn't have the nida right now, but the tum'ah of the nida, the impurity states, only Jewish women. So until she goes into the mikveh, that's when the impurity leaves the body. So as long as she was in her period, they slept separately. Now once the blood stopped, they moved into the same bed, but still did not make sin. And he waited until she goes to the mikveh. And he died young with all the Torah that he learned. So Eliyahu HaNavi asked her, he started to investigate, because she was asking, and nobody knew the secrets from their bedrooms. How are they supposed to know? Nobody knew to give her an answer. So he got it out of her. And he said to her, you see, Hashem does not prefer one person from the other. Everyone gets what he deserves. We'll finish with a story that happened by me. You know, a few times in my life, when I felt that I'm speaking to a person and that's it, there's nothing else I can do. I tried everything, and the person was very stubborn. And I say to myself, listen, I already lost the argument. I lost the argument. He's about to go, and I'm about to go, and who knows what's going to be with this guy or girl. So the point is, what do I have to lose? There's something that the big tzaddikim used to do. It's called goral agra. There's two goral. It's called goral agra, goral achida. That after you say a special prayer, you tell the person, let's open the Torah and see what Hashem wants. Make a special prayer, and he opens the Torah. And you say, whatever comes on the right page, it's a message from Hashem, you have to do. So one time, many years ago, it was about 11 or 12 years ago, this story happened. I used to go to give shiurim in Brooklyn, close to Borough Park, but the other side of Ditmas Avenue, the other side of Ocean Parkway. There was an office of a car service company, all Israeli drivers. Since so many drivers are there, all of them not religious, They made me a lecture there in their office. So I went there. There was one Israeli guy. His name was Nati, Nathan, taxi driver. And he has a girlfriend, and she was a waitress in Jerusalem Steakhouse in Avenue J in Brooklyn. Giving you names, you can go and check. And she was a waitress there, and she had a friend which was also a waitress over there. Her name was Dana. We have two girls, and this guy Nati, he lives with his girlfriend. They two chilonim. So now he came to my shiurim there. I made few shiurim in this car service. So Baruch Hashem became Shomer Shabbat, and I invited him to come to me for Shabbat. So he said, "Can I bring my girlfriend with me?" What do we do in a case like this? We make them sleep by the neighbor, do try to separate between them, not to continue to make scenes. So they came, the two girls and him, and we had many other guests. Now in Shabbat morning, they sit in my table. What am I going to talk about? Huh? How beautiful is mitzvah tefillin? How great is to keep Shabbat? What do I have to talk about when a guy and a girl who lives together and makes Isurei Karet probably every day, sitting in my table? What am I supposed to talk about? Ve'elisha ben-nida tumata lo tikrav legalot ervata, right? The sin of Nida. Maybe 2.5-3 hours I'm giving a speech about it. And I say to him, you have to separate. So he say to me, we cannot afford 2 rents. Well, rent for me, rent for her. It's a matter of money. So I said to him, no problem. You come to the yeshiva, you don't pay rent. We have a room for you. And they can go to the midrashia in Brooklyn for the girls. We have room for them. Nobody pays rent. Even the rent you pay right now, you save. All you have to do is learn Torah 2 hours a night, the girls, in the midrashia. And the rest of the day, they work as usual. What can be better than that? And you come. You need anyway to come to the yeshiva. Yeah, no, we're not ready, you know, the Yetzer Hara. After almost 3 hours that we argue about this, I said, listen, I lost the argument, what can I do? There's nothing we can do. So I told him, you know what? You don't listen to me, maybe you listen to Hashem. So he looks at me, what do you mean listen to Hashem? I said, we're going to do Goral. We're going to make a special bracha, say Hashem, show me please what to do. Whatever comes on the right side, on the top, it's a message. You cannot ignore it. So he looks at her, and they go like this. They didn't believe what's going to happen now. So, okay. We say a few words. I say, open. You went like this. Boom. First line on the right. Ve'elisha ve'nida tumata lo tikrav legalot ervata. First line, this girl, Shelly, her name, his ex-girlfriend, today's wife, she gave such a scream and ran crying to the room. Baruch Hashem, the next day I put both girls in the midrashia, brought him to the yeshiva, they made aliyah to Israel, they got married, and there's a happy end to the story. Hashem made a miracle, clear miracle. It wouldn't happen. Who knows where they are today? Continue to make scenes, forget it. And one time, I had a story like this with another Yemenite guy. Now, you know, if it's a Yemenite guy, it's a triple miracle. Because convince a Yemenite, after he insists that he doesn't want to do something, to convince him, if you ask Mashiach to come that day, Hashem will send Mashiach. That's how tough this guy was. I told him, Wednesday I'm coming to my weekly shiur in Brooklyn. I'm coming before to pick you up. You come with me to my lecture, and from there we go right to Monsi to the yeshiva. Agreed. I go to Avenue U. He lives with his father. Parents divorced. Him and his father lives together in an apartment in Brooklyn. The guy's name, Ron. Yemenite guy, Israeli. I arrive to Avenue U, I call him, no, where are you? Come downstairs, I'm right here, 8:30, the lecture started 9. Come down. He said, listen, there's problems. My father heard I'm going to yeshiva. He got upset. Maybe we'll do it next week when he relaxed. I said to him, my friend, I came all the way here. I don't live without you. Bring your bag and let's go. He said, no, no, I'm serious. It's not a joke. My father is very upset. He heard I want to leave the work and to go to learn Torah. It's not a good time now to pack a bag and this. I told him, well, we made a deal, no? I came all the way up here. What do I have to do here in Avenue U? I'm downstairs. Come down. I know the Yetzer Hara. Got to break it. Maybe 25 minutes we argue on the phone. Then he said to me, listen, you put me in the problems with my father. He's getting angry here. Let me come downstairs and I talk to you. We came downstairs. We're standing now, 9 o'clock already. We're standing in the street of Avenue U and arguing for another 10 minutes. It's 9:10. People starting to call. Where are you? People are waiting. I say to him, you see, I'm not even going to give this lecture. I don't care. Let them wait until the morning. It's all on your head. He said, don't do this to me. Why are you putting pressure on me? I don't like pressure. I say to him, I don't know. By me, a deal is a deal. When I shake hands, I don't care. I'm not backing up on my word. But my father, well, you want me to have a fight with my father? I say, and you want to have a fight with your real father? More important than your father. You're right. I want to come. I'm dying to come. But I can't. Make long story short, it's already almost 9:20 by now. Already 50 minutes I'm sweating with this guy. And I say to myself, obviously he's not going to come. So what's going to be? I have a chumash in my car. I told him, let's ask Hashem. Whatever happened, happened. If Hashem tells you have to come, you come? He said, what do you mean? I said, we're going to make a prayer and you open whatever comes on the top of the right side. That is as a message from Shamayim. You come or no? I said, what do I have to lose? Nothing comes. Anyway, it won't come. What do I have to lose? She said, yeah, it's working. I said, we'll see in a minute. Yeah. He said, okay, I come. If from Hashem I come. We say the prayer and this. I say, open. Boom. Open. What happened? והנשארים בכם עמקו בעוונם אשר מעלו בי. If you stay, nothing would left out of you for making a crime against me. If you stay. That's what it says. והנשארים בכם. If you stay. We argue if to come, he wants to stay. He open. If you stay, nothing would left from you. He said, give me 2 minutes. He ran upstairs. He brought a bag. Today is a rabbi in Bnei Brak. Wow. We had a guy here from Queens, a few blocks away from here. Israeli guy, Ami, his name. He married to a woman, a girl or not, both of them. And he had a ponytail. Started to give lecture to the Israelis. We're talking these stories about 14, 15 years ago. So I invited them for Shabbat. Husband and wife, chilonim, is starting to become Shomrei Shabbat, Baruch Hashem. So I say to him, Ami, you know, I live in the heart of the religious neighborhood in America. You want to come like this with a ponytail, all the Hasidish kid will call you a goy, a goy. They never saw something like this, that a Jew has a ponytail. They only see Jews with beard and yarmulke. Why don't you go and have a haircut? He said to me, you know how many years it took me to grow this ponytail? You tell me like this, go have a haircut? I said, okay, I just don't want you to get offended. You know, kids, they don't know. They will come after you all Shabbat. So he said, don't worry, I'm going to take care of it. I'm going to push it under the hat, and nobody would know. So he came with the limousine. You know the limousine hats? Yeah, we should take a picture. How you got this hat? I don't know. The limousine drivers, you know. And he put the ponytail, pushed it all the way in, and you couldn't really see anything. Motzei Shabbat, I said to him, Ami, my heart doesn't let me let you leave my house with this kind of horse tail. Let me give you a haircut. Let me cut the ponytail. No, no. You know, when a person is in love with his hair, you put $10,000 cash, he won't agree. That's the heart of the Yetzer Hara, the hair. No, no, what are you talking about? For years I'm growing it. Say, Ami, come on, you're Shomer Shabbat already. Grow up. What is this? Bottom line, you know the story. We argue, argue. So I said to him, okay, let's ask Hashem. And he said, what do you mean? I explained to him. He looks at his wife. She said, okay, that's fair. If Hashem tells you you're not going to take it off, she said. He said, okay. We open. What came? Unbelievable. Miracles. These miracles are just as big as the miracles that you read in the Torah. What's the chance that something like this would happen? What's the chance? Because you need the one verse in the Tanakh from tens of thousands of verses that this one will come on the right side on the top row again and again. What's the chance? So what happened? He opened. First row. First row on the top, on the right side. והיה כאשר תריד ופרקת אולו מעל צווארך תחיה. If you remove it from your neck, you would live. מהר, מהר, to the shower. He said, no, no, you don't know how to cut hair. But I give you my word, tomorrow morning I'm having a haircut. Today you should see how his hair shaved. Since that day, he doesn't let his hair grow more than a week. Finally, the Yetzer Hara left him. We had few miracles like this. But to count on miracles? We don't need to count on miracles. We know the Torah. We know the truth. We don't need miracles. Sometimes Hashem agreed to do miracles. Whatever, it's the schut of this person. Could be his father, grandfather. We don't know. We'll see you Bezrat Hashem next Monday. This Shabbat I'm going to be in Chicago, but I'm coming back Sunday. Okay, so next Monday we on the schedule. Tomorrow, every Tuesday now, it's already the fourth week in a row, the third week in a row. I speak in Jamaica Estate, 80-14 Chevy Chase Street, right off Union Turnpike. Every Tuesday, 8:45 in a big nice shul over there that they built a year ago. In Jamaica. Thank you very much. We'll see you next week. Rabbi Hananiah ben Akashia Omer.